and experience allow you to help create jobs for Massachusetts?
Well, I wouldn't think it's so much my community service that will help me in developing the economic policy for the state or working on developing an economic strategy for this state. I would really think it's been my experience, as I've stated previously, working out in industries and looking at regulations that have hamstrung companies to be able to add on employees. Let me give you an example. There was some recent changes in workers' comp legislation that I had CEOs of companies telling me they would move to hiring temporary help versus putting on workers. So we actually had legislation on the book in workers' comp that functioned as a disincentive to job growth. Now, and I have to commend the lobbying effects of the business community, that legislation's no longer on the books because they went to Governor Weld and told him what that bill was doing to their ability to grow jobs in the state of Massachusetts. So I certainly am, do you say you're pro-business? I'd say I'm pro-jobs, and that's what you'll see me doing. Working on policies, creating legislation that supports the promotion of jobs in Massachusetts.
Thank you very much, Brad. If you had 60 seconds and your background and experience, sure, and how that allow you to help create jobs for Massachusetts.
I would simply ask people to look at my record as a selectman, whether it's support for an equalized tax rate of commercial and residential property taxes, support for various zoning changes to attract and enhance business development, the creation of the Water Advisory Task Force in the town of North Reading to ensure quality and to ensure quality and quantity adequate supply of water, support for the creation of a sewer district in the Concord Street area. This is a business benefit to the town of North Reading, an environmental water benefit to the town of Reading. More importantly, my record as a candidate will show that I've spent almost all of my campaign funds used for the printing of stationery, brochures, stickers, signs, and the like within the district I seek to represent. That's local businesses that employ local people, and that is my concern foremost and first of all as a state representative.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are getting very close to being out of time. If you'd all like to take a deep breath and another sip of water, it's time for the closing statements. Again, by our very scientific method of a toss of a coin, I do believe the order of business here for our closing statements, and they will be given 3 minutes each for their closing statements. First, candidate Brad Jones.
Okay. Again, let me thank the League for their sponsorship of this forum and everyone for their participation. Just to go back on a couple of issues, to kind of clarify the record that was so misrepresented, I am pro-choice on the issue of abortion. I recognize a woman's right to choose within the parameters established by Roe versus Wade. On the issue of the MWRA, I would support changing the present assessment formula from a population-based system to a usage-based system. You pay for what you use. I've also signed on to legislation with Representative Bill Cass of Wakefield that would change the budgeting authority of the advisory board to give towns and their representatives more impact, and that will benefit the towns greatly. Tonight's forum leaves you with much to think about over the next 19 days before you vote on March 1st. This election is about electing someone that is in touch with you on the issues you care about, whether it be local or state. This election is about local aid, mandate funding and reform, legislative reform, campaign finance reform, economic growth, crime, and many other issues. Throughout the course of this debate and campaign, I put forth my views on a number of issues. When you enter the voting booth on March 1st, I believe you will find my positions are reflective of yours across the spectrum. For the past 3 years as a legislative aide, I've responded to thousands of letters, phone calls, and personal inquiries, often at home. Whether advocating on an issue or handling a constituent problem, I have a record of service to the people of this district. I understand the meaning, the obligation, the honor, and the hard work which public service entails. I'm proud of the record of accomplishment that I've helped to compile these past 3 years, securing funding for Reading Senior Center, the reconstruction of Route 28, the location of Medco Pharmaceuticals in Wilmington, the transfer of 14 acres of land to the town of North Reading. I'm proud of my involvement dealing with local officials and answering questions or providing information. I'm proud of the record of accessibility I helped provide for the past 3 years that kept people informed. I've accepted every opportunity to go into our schools or greet our students at the State House and talk to them about the governmental process. I'm most proud of my record of addressing constituent requests, whether it was getting the blueprints for the replica of Henry David Thoreau's house in Walden Pond for a Reading resident after you tried for 3 years without success, or the hours I spent at Boston City Hall resolving an erroneous excise tax problem that threatened to prevent a citizen from renewing his registration, or working to get personal care attendant assistance for yet another, While I could never guarantee the result in every case I handled over 3 years, I did guarantee that I would expend every effort. That is a record I will continue. Ultimately, your decision rests on whether you are satisfied with the high level of service you received the past 3 years, be it on the issues or in the resolution of constituent problems. If you are, then I ask for your vote on March 1st as the candidate with a background and experience to continue that record of service, accomplishment, and accessibility. Thank you and good night.
That is your Republican candidate for State Representative Brad Jones. And now, with 3 minutes for her closing statement, the Republican candidate, I'm sorry, the Democratic candidate. I just said that, didn't I?
Cut me to the quick.
Back to the primary, oh, yes.
Back to the primary. All right, 3 minutes, Sandy Traynor.
Well, we've spent a significant amount of time discussing some important issues that the next state representative will be grappling with. But I hope my philosophy and my commitment to serve will be convincing to you to vote for Traynor on March 1st. However, I expect that there will be some other strategies at work to help convince you to vote for my opponent. And I'd like to spend a few of my minutes, my last few minutes, alerting you to some state party policies and politics that might be rolling out here in Reading, North Reading, and Wilmington. First, they bring in the heavy hitters to the district to pull in some big monies for the campaign coffers. Well, you know, hey, the governor's popular. There's no problem with that. If he was a Democrat, I'd invite him in. Second, in the final weeks of the election, you'll see a lot of signs and a lot of phone calling because they bring in lots of Republican Party people to help in the process. Hey, that's okay too. I'll use every resource I can to reach the voter. But the third thing that's been happening in the special elections is something that I do have a problem with. There's a real strong need to recover to keep the Republican seat. And what I hear happens in the special election is that in the final days, you can expect to see something arrive in the mail throughout the district, what is called in the vernacular a smear sheet that's on the candidate, the Democratic candidate, and it'll arrive conveniently at your doorstep on Saturday, where there's no time allowed for a response by the Democratic candidate. Now, I sat there and said to myself, well, what could the Republicans ever try and smear me on? And then it became obvious, and it's been mentioned here tonight, and so I'll have to give you a confession that when I opened up Brad's material and saw the question under campaign financing, would you vote for someone who missed a filing date? Well, that question was asked for a reason. Yes, the Traynor campaign missed a filing date, but it was totally an innocent mistake on the part of my treasurer. This is a special election, and we had to file all our donors by the 24th of January. Because you're a campaign, there's always a January 9th filing date. So my campaign treasurer, who is a scientist, very logical and very scrupulous and very detailed, assumed that by filing on the 24th that met the letter of the law. Not even the letter of the law, was more than adequate because it was the latest information. Well, it turns out that he was wrong. He talked to the state and they said, no problem, that was okay. But this is going to be made an issue, and I think you'll see it arrive on your doorstep like it has occurred in both North Andover as well as into a special election south of us.
Your time is up.
So voter beware. Hopefully tonight's debate will have helped you
make
a decision. Thanks.
That is your Democratic candidate for State Representative, Sandy Traynor. To Sandy Traynor, to Brad Jones, to Brad Jones, to Sandy Traynor, we thank you very much. Again, the special election is March 1st. On behalf of our candidates, our panel of reporters tonight, our audience here in the lecture hall, and of course the viewers at home on television, thank you to the League of Women Voters, Reading and North Reading. Really appreciate your efforts. I'm Gary LaPierre. Thank you very much and good night.